In fact, it's more than important. We all agree that we're dealing with a national and global crisis with an urgent existential danger to the world. So I'm very happy to lead off this conference with the a description of the procedures and the timelines for nuclear Armageddon. In state of shape. I'll call it the protocol. The protocol has its main function and its main virtue is that it concentrates the power and authority over the use of nuclear weapons at the highest level of the executive branch of the U.S. government, the presidency, and keeping it out of the hands of the military and others. That's very important. The second main function and virtue is that it enables the president to be able to respond rapidly and decisively to an attack, a nuclear attack, by an enemy whose missiles may fly from one side of the planet to the other in 30 minutes, or whose missiles launch from submarines in the oceans may fly to targets in the United States in 15 minutes. So it's very critical to be able to have a protocol that allows the president to consider the use of nuclear weapons and, if necessary, to order their use and have a process of implementation begun in a very, very short period of time. Now, the downsides of these of this protocol is sort of the flip side of virtues. By virtue of the speed and concentration of authority in this protocol, the president has an opportunity to effectively railroad the nuclear commanders and forces into executing even a very large nuclear strike first, preventively, or second, to railroad that process, even though it may be a very misguided decision. It may be a decision that's based on an impulsive psychology and to other factors that lead to a very bad call. The other downside of this protocol, which we used to talk about a lot more than we do today, is that the protocol itself, because it's so rooted in speed and concentrated authority, it can railroad the president into authorizing in a hasty way the use of nuclear weapons based on indications that may be false of an attack underway. And so there's the possibility that we could launch on false warning, believing that we are retaliating, but in fact, we're launching first. So there's another path to the first use of nuclear weapons, which is a false alarm, of which we have had several on each side, the Russian and the Soviet and the US side, over the course of the Cold War, one or two of which have been quite serious. And Bill Perry has intimate knowledge of one of them, who I care to share. The one irony is that during the Cold War, to my knowledge, a false alarm never led to the notification of the president in the beginning of the protocol that I'm just about to describe. The false alarms were caught before that happened. Ironically, today, with the proliferation of ballistic missiles over the last decade, and there's been a huge surge in ballistic missile proliferation and testing, you find that missile launches today from China, from Iran, from North Korea have led on multiple occasions to involve sufficient ambiguity that presidents have actually been notified about the ongoing event. So let me just briefly try to describe the protocol. How much time do we have left?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, great. Beginning with the early warning function, the effort to detect a possible attack against North America and to notify the president. process of deliberation. Every single day, the early morning staffs out in Colorado and Omaha pick up events that require a second look to determine whether we're under attack or not. And it could be the Japanese launching a satellite into space. It could be the North Koreans testing a missile. It could be the United States testing a missile out of California. We look at it, or wildfire in the Southwest. There are multiple things that happen every day that require some sort of analysis. They're usually dismissed quickly. Once or twice a month, there's something that happens that requires a really close second look. And once in a blue moon, something happens and all hell breaks loose. And those are the false alarms that I was referring to earlier. If there are indications received by these staffs that are 24/7 that something is amiss, that we may be under attack, how much time do you think they have from the time the first sensor data arrives until they have to provide a preliminary assessment as to whether North America is under attack?
6 minutes.
It's 3 minutes. 3 minutes to make that assessment. And if the assessment is medium or high confidence that this is a threat, they initiate a process that will bring the president and his top advisors into an emergency teleconference, no matter what time of day or night it may be. Now, at this point, from what I'm going to say about the protocol from this point on, you can imagine that the president has decided to initiate a conference with his top advisors to consider the first use of the nuclear weapons, which is the main topic of this conference, of course. This is of increasing concern to me because the United States does not have a no first use policy, and furthermore, under current review undertaken by the Pentagon, primarily of our nuclear policy, there is an emerging thesis that we should move further away from the first use. That is, that we should be considering the use of nuclear weapons in a wider range of contingencies. And we are on the verge of, in fact, modifying our assurance to non-nuclear weapons countries that we may use nuclear weapons against them. In contradiction to the position adopted by the Obama administration. So if this emergency conference is convened, then you have the president and his top advisors. Those typically include statutory members of the National Security Council, which would be essentially the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of State. It would also normally include the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, although I think he participates at the discretion and invitation of the Secretary of Defense, as well as the National Security Advisor, and a number of key military command posts and personnel, the most important of which is the commander of strategic forces based in Omaha, Nebraska, who commands all of our nuclear strategic weapons. Time and circumstances permitting, that general would brief the president on his nuclear options and their consequences. He's not going to give a big, long briefing like Lenny just gave. He's going to have to boil this down into very, very brief sound bites for the president. Boy, here are your options and here are the consequences, and he'll ask a couple questions. Do you want to withhold attacks on Kiev? Back in the Cold War days, but Moscow today, for example. And that briefing, if we're under attack, could be as short as 30 seconds. Of course, if the president is considering the first use of nuclear weapons, then that timeline is not nearly as short. That conversation could last for quite a long period of time. If we're under attack, then the president is going to have to consider his options in probably about 6 minutes. 6 minutes is a fair estimate, given the way that this protocol tends to work. If we're not under attack, he can deliberate longer. Then he makes a decision. What option am I going to pursue? Am I going to decide to attack North Korea with the current pre-programmed attack plan, which I, as I estimate, would have roughly 80 nuclear aim points in North Korea. Or what, depending on circumstances, obviously. But let's say he chooses an option, and that's going to be conveyed instantly to the war room in the Pentagon, National Level Threat Command, because that war room is the location that probably initiated this conference in the first place, and they're listening in on the conversation, and they're beginning, actually, as they hear the president moving toward a decision to use nukes, to prepare a launch order. Before they do that, I want to make clear that it's not the Secretary of Defense who confirms the president's decision or has the right to veto it, or nor does anyone else have the authority to override the decision. They may not even necessarily be asked for their advice. This is a nuclear bomb, in fact, that has almost carte blanche command over the nuclear forces. He's going to convey his decision to the war room, which is going to ask him to authenticate his identity using a special code. It's referred colloquially as the BISCOD, otherwise known more officially as the Gold Code, and if that code matches, the war room in the Pentagon, or it could be some alternate, depending, will format a launch order that's going to be transmitted down the chain of command to the executing commanders of the submarines and the landings, rockets, and the bombers. And that launch order is roughly the length of a tweet. The tweet launch order is formatted. It contains all the information necessary for the crews down the chain of command to launch their forces. Time to fire. The war plan that's been picked has a unlock code that the crews need in order to actually physically unlock their weapons prior to launch, and special authentication codes that the crews check with the codes in their safes to satisfy themselves that this order came from the president, even though these codes are not in the possession of the president or in the possession of the military. Okay, so that takes 2 minutes, 10 seconds to authenticate, a minute or two to format and transmit an order. And I have 2 minutes left. And I tell you, in 2 minutes, from right now, from the receipt of that order down the chain of command, missiles could be leaving their silos, because it takes only about 1 minute for a Minuteman crew in the plain states of the Midwest to carry out the launch checklist. I did this, it was my job in the 1970s, and it took me 1 minute. We delayed a little bit for classified reasons, but that's how long it took, and that's how long it takes today. Those crews turn the keys. Before they do that, they enter the war plan that they received in a tweet launch order, which goes out to all the missiles, and the missiles know what pre-programmed wartime targets to strike. So in peacetime, yes, they're aimed at the ocean, broad ocean, but changing their target set to Moscow or any other target is as easy as changing the channel on your TV set using a remote. So within a minute or two, there could be today up to 400 high-yield strategic weapons launched out of their silos at their targets, whatever those targets may be. Submarines take about 10 minutes longer because it takes longer for them to target their missiles and position the submarine, proper depth, et cetera, et cetera. But if they received this order that just went down 2 minutes ago, they could fire, and within 15 minutes, they would be launching missiles out of their tubes for submarines all over in the Pacific or the Atlantic Oceans. And they fire them one at a time every 15 seconds. And lastly, the bombers. And my time's up, and I'll tell you about the bombers later. The bombers would take 8 to 10 hours to reach their launch points if they were already on alert. They're not normally today, peacetime on alert. They don't even have bombs on board. So they would have to be generated in a crisis before they were usable. So bottom line, the president wakes up, he gives the order basically through a system that's so streamlined that there's almost no gatekeeping going on here. And within 5 minutes, 400 bombs are leaving on missiles launched out of the Midwest, and about 10 minutes later, another 400 on submarines, right now today. 800, roughly the equivalent of, in round numbers, 15,000 Hiroshima bombs. That's all it takes. And we're not alone, folks. The same basic posture exists in Russia, and I'm going to talk about that this afternoon. So thank you very much.